When you're a child, your parents or guardians teach you certain values. Don't hit. It's not yours. Don't take it. Keep your promises. You may disagree with the ideas or views of other people, but you don't hit them. You may disapprove of what other people do. They may read books you don't like, engage in sexual activities that you don't like, and ingest substances that you don't like, but you wouldn't break down their door and haul them away in handcuffs, and you certainly wouldn't kill them. You can't, but government can. And the power of government is used to force people to live the way others think they should. There are behaviors that threaten our life, liberty, or property. Murder, theft, fraud. These behaviors are called crimes, and we have police to protect us and apprehend those who commit them. But are thoughts crimes? Is using a word or phrase that's considered racist a crime? Is simple possession of an illegal drug a crime? If there is no victim, there is no crime, and Michigan locks up too many people who haven't harmed anyone. Like most people, you prefer prosperity over poverty. Now, there are some cultures where poverty is a virtue, builds character. But for the most part, we want to be able to provide for ourselves and or our families. When we see those who are in poverty or struggling, we want to help them. But we wouldn't break into our neighbor's house, steal all their stuff, just to help the poor. We certainly wouldn't stop someone on the street, force them to open their wallet, and put money into a Salvation Army kettle. The best way to promote prosperity is through a free market capitalist system. Even Bono likes it now. There is little doubt that some corporations are engaged in practices that are unethical, illegal, and harmful to the prosperity of people. I agree. Many, particularly on the left, blame capitalism. But we don't have a capitalist system. We have a crony capitalist or crapitalist system. Currently, our political class in Lansing protects through arbitrary regulation, bails out, incentivizes, and rewards bad business behavior. Through the Michigan Economic Development Corporation, our government allows these businesses to privatize their profits while socializing their losses. True free market capitalism always ensures that bad business practices are punished. They go out of business. And good business stewardship is rewarded. To allow everyone to prosper, revoke government's authority to regulate, subsidize, bail out, and give preferential treatment to business. Politicians will do anything, say anything, to get elected. They promise to fix transportation, provide a world-class education, provide better health care, and always more jobs. Every year, legislation is passed, bureaucracies are created or enlarged, and taxes are raised. But those promises seem to fall short. Providing education is in Michigan's Constitution, but nowhere does it mention we have to break the bank doing it. We, the taxpayer, are always told we need to invest more. This really means we pay more in taxes so they can spend more on government programs. Cut the spending, return that money to those who earn it, and let choice and the forces of free market competition be put to work. Martin Luther King Jr. once said, "The soft-minded man always fears change. He feels security in the status quo, and he has an almost morbid fear of the new. For him, the greatest pain is the pain of a new idea." My new idea is actually an old idea, freedom. I want to restore your freedom to determine your own path and allow you to have the power to make your own choices. I want to get government out of your wallet, your bedroom, your body, and your business. Help me restore your power to live free.
Michigan is faced with an array of problems. Too many of our K-12 schools are not delivering the promised and much-needed education of our young people. Our roads and bridges are among the worst in all 50 states. College costs continue to soar beyond the reach of most of our friends and neighbors, and that in turn amplifies the problems in our K-12 schools. It is a cycle that spirals downward so sinisterly that many do not notice until they are overwhelmed. Perhaps worst among our many problems is the failure of government of, by, and for the people. The bad news is that most of our problems are of our own making. The good news is that means we can actually do something about them. When was the last time you talked with colleagues or neighbors and heard them say they had a good experience with government? When was the last time you asserted your right to go to the polls and actually voted for someone instead of voting against the other guy? When was the last time you felt that your own life and family were secure enough that you could devote some of your own resources to looking out for the greater good? I know, we volunteer at the soup kitchen, we send a check to very worthwhile causes, some of us even go to our children's parent-teacher conferences. But when was the last time you said, I think I'll get Betty from next door and John from across the street and go to the city council meeting? When did you last say, those jerks in Lansing are really screwing up the tax thing and I'm going to give them a call or write a letter and tell them a better way to do it? We all complain, we have that right. The problem is more of us need to be willing and able to stand up and act, to say, hey, you got that wrong. If you did it this way, it would be better or simpler or cheaper or just easier to accept. I am Paul Hominick and I have the right to complain, and now I'm taking the responsibility that goes with that right and acting. I am Paul Hominick and I'm running for governor of the great state of Michigan. I am the Green Party candidate for governor. Many of you are now thinking, yeah, like I'm going to waste my vote that way. The truth is, voting for a Democrat or a Republican is the biggest waste. We've had decades of that, and look at what it has gotten us. If you think doing the same thing over and over again is somehow going to get you different results, well, I wish you luck with that. The truth is, the Green Party is more than you think and not near as crazy as you've been told. Most of us are just like you. We want a better life for our kids, fair opportunities, a safe place to live, effective education, clean water to drink, and friends and neighbors that have those things too. Many people are green without ever having joined a party or attended a meeting. We believe that government has a role in a free society. We believe that everyone deserves to be treated fairly. We believe that we should keep the world we live in clean and healthy. We believe that government should work from the people up. We believe that most disagreements can be solved without violence. We believe that opportunity can and should be available to everyone. Nothing too off the wall or far-fetched there. Solutions are found through exchange of ideas, and most people are actually pretty good at that. Republicans and Democrats have not been interested in solutions for years. You know that. I don't have all the solutions, but I have a good start for some, and I know where to look to find the rest. Let's look at challenges with our K-12 schools. We know that students learn differently and tell our teachers to adapt and change teaching styles to meet each student's needs. We then turn around and say, we're going to test them all the same, and your job depends on them all doing what the test says. We make the schools responsible for social problems that should be solved by all of us, and then complain that they are not using their resources for education wisely, and so we take more money away from them as punishment. Where is the solution in that? As governor, I will work to give control of the schools back to the local districts. That means you. The local districts, your community, should set the curriculum, the standards, and the requirements without having their funding threatened if they did not do it one certain way. When we had that local control, our schools were innovative, teachers were motivated to learn and try new things, students were hopeful that they would find their dreams accepted and welcomed. When a district creates something that is effective, other districts will copy it far faster than any law or decree could make them. Please go to my website or invite me to come speak to your neighborhood or organization, and I'll be happy to share more solution starters on how we work together to solve our problems. I am Paul Hominick, and I'm asking you to take action. Open the door to new possibilities. Vote for me and break the cycle of doing the same thing again and again. Thank you.
I'm Godfrey Dillard, and I'm the Democratic Party nominee for Michigan's Secretary of State. I'm a husband and father of two, who wants to make the Secretary of State office work for you. I've had the great fortune to have been an attorney who has amassed more than 40 years of civil, criminal, and international litigation and transactional experience. I've even argued a case before the United States Supreme Court in our nation's capital. A longtime Michigan resident, I've been educated at two of our state's great institutions of higher education, Eastern Michigan University and the University of Michigan Law School. I've also traveled the world and served as a Deputy Consul General for our federal government's State Department. I'm running for Michigan Secretary of State because I want to enhance the fundamental right to vote for the 7.4 million people in our state who are registered to cast a ballot. If elected on November 4th, I will increase voter participation at the ballot box in all 83 counties. I also want to improve enforcement of campaign financing laws, protect the data of citizens, and reduce licensing fees. Consider this. Currently, the Secretary of State Department budgets only 3% of its total annual allocation of $224 million to elections. Are you kidding me? That is totally inadequate to improve the access to voting. If I'm elected, I will promote accessibility for all. I will improve services for seniors. I will lobby the legislature to authorize absentee ballot voting for any reason. I will institute voting pilot programs to evaluate voting by mail, as well as voting early and same-day voting. I will restore transparency to office, all of its functions. I pledge to improve election support services with increased employee training and outreach to citizens. I will implement a supercenter concept, which will provide additional capacity and reduce wait times. Finally, I will respect the privacy rights of all Michigan residents, period. I'm a former college basketball player. Help me score a victory for the people. Join our movement. Visit my website, www.godfreydillard.com. Follow me on Facebook and Twitter by entering my name. I'm Godfrey Dillard, Democratic Party candidate for Michigan Secretary of State. Vote for me on November 4th. Yes, we can. Yes, we must. Yes, we will.
Hello, my name is Jim Fulner. I'm the Libertarian candidate for U.S. Senate. I think I'm the best choice you're going to have this fall, because unlike my opponent, I'm not running to get a shiny badge to tell you what to do. I'm running to tell the Michiganders the life we could have if we eliminated force for political and social gain. My platform has four basic aspects: ending all wars, the separation of marriage and state, the promotion and use of free software, and the elimination of taxation in the privately owned Federal Reserve. Ending all wars. The current administration seems bent on continuing the actions in the Middle East that were started by George Bush, that the administration we have now was elected to eliminate. They've been late on shutting down Guantanamo. We're now going to fight ISIS to try to overthrow the government of Syria, when there's a more peaceful solution. In a libertarian society, any actions currently performed by the military would have to be performed by private volunteers, those who are completely voluntary and can quit at any time they want, and are funded equally by those who believe the cause is just. If we were to have such a military acquisition now, I believe those in power would find more peaceful, cheaper solutions than what we have going forward. Regardless, the United States has no business being the world policeman, and even with a taxpayer-funded military, I would recommend that we bring home all troops, Air Force, Marines, sailors, soldiers, and Coast Guardsmen like myself, back within the borders of the United States, solely to defend against any potential threats to the people who live here in this vicinity. Ending the privately Federal Reserve and all taxation. In a libertarian society, anything currently funded by the government would likely be better provided by the free market. Short of a libertarian society, I recommend that we adopt Eric Huru's People's Central Bank solution. This is an idea that we allow for a 50-state-managed People's Central Bank to replace the privately owned Federal Reserve, and then fund all four levels of government with the interest on loans to private sector borrowers. Currently, you have the ability to create money out of thin air. When you go to the gas station and you use your credit card to fill the pump, that money doesn't come out of a free money folder. That's being created by you. Wouldn't you like the interest you're paying on that to go to pay for the roads instead of going to pay to fund the Bank of America, Chase, or all those other large corporations? The separation of marriage and state. The government should treat all people as individuals, whether single, married, gay, or straight. If the government treated everyone as individuals, it would practically eliminate the so-called gay marriage debate. This is one issue that I've found over the years, that liberals and conservatives, if you let them talk about it long enough, will agree. The libertarians are right on this one. The government has no more business telling you you are or are not married as they are saying who is and is not baptized. Lastly, the promotion and use of free software. Free software is defined by the Free Software Society Foundation, www.fsf.org. It would allow people to be able to use software that they can see the source code of. We could finally verify that the information that's being written on your voting tag is what's actually being sent through the voting machine. Moreover, if we allowed government, military, schools, etc., to utilize only free software, the betterment to society would be substantial, because those who currently are looking for proprietary software as a way to make their own profit will be looking to better all of us, because they know what they're seeing would be used. There's always a lot more you can learn. I recommend that you read my website at www.jimfulner.com, and most importantly, between now and Election Day, read the Declaration of Independence and decide if the government we have now is still protecting individual rights. If so, please vote for me. If not, you have a much more important thing to do between now and Election Day. Take to the streets and start your own libertarian revolution.
Hello, everyone. My name is Gary Peters, and I'm running to succeed Carl Levin in the United States Senate. And I would be honored to earn your vote this election. First, a little bit about my background. My family has been in Michigan for generations. I was born and raised in this state in a typical middle-class family. My father was a public school teacher, and my mom a nurse's aide. I married my wife, Colleen, and together we raised three children. I'm proud to have raised my family in the same state I grew up in, but I worry about the future of our state. Michigan must continue being a place where anyone who works hard and plays by the rules can have a fair shot. Growing up, my parents always instilled in me the importance of service. My dad served in World War II, and he taught me the importance of giving back. So at 34 years old, I joined the United States Navy Reserve, and after the 9/11 terrorist attacks, I signed up again to drill. I decided to run for the U.S. Senate because I'm worried that the future is going what it's going to look like for my children and for families all across the state. I want to make sure that Michigan can always be a place where folks can find good jobs and where you can pursue your dreams, whether that means starting your own business or furthering the next step in your education. Since the first day I announced my campaign, I've been traveling around Michigan on a listening tour to hear from middle-class families, small business owners, farmers, and veterans all across our great state. To me, the most important conversations are those that happen around a kitchen table. And over the past year, I've found that Michiganders have a lot in common when it comes to the challenges folks are talking about with their families around that table. In the U.S. Senate, I will continue to fight for Michigan as a common sense, practical problem solver to help reinvest in our economy, rebuild our middle class, and create a strong future. One of my top priorities in the U.S. Senate will be to continue making sure that small businesses have the resources they need to survive, to compete, and to succeed. Our small businesses are the engines to economic growth. They hire locally and are the drivers in reinvesting in our economy. I'm proud to have championed two small business lending programs that have given resources and capital to small businesses across our state. And thanks to these programs, Thousands of jobs have been created or saved right here in Michigan alone. I am also committed to protecting and preserving Medicare and Social Security. I've fought back against partisan far-right plans that would end the Medicare guarantee and privatize Social Security. To me, Medicare and Social Security are sacred promises and ones that we must honor and protect. Michigan has over 2 million people on Social Security and 1.7 million seniors on Medicare, including my own mother. My mom counts on Medicare, so I can tell you firsthand, I get it. This is a family issue. We need to make sure Medicare is there for them and for future generations who hope to retire with dignity. I have big ideas for Michigan, and I think we need to invest in our strengths, what we do better than anyone else, and do more of it. We have the best workers. We have the best thinkers and innovators. We make things better than anyone else in the world, and we have some of the most important natural resources, from the Great Lakes to our forest. We're also uniquely and strategically located between Chicago and Toronto, and that's why I think we can transform Michigan into an innovation and a logistics hub that can create new jobs, encourage entrepreneurship and startups, and strengthen our economy overall. And that starts with building the new International Trade Bridge, which will support thousands of jobs. And I'm glad to be working with Governor Snyder and others to build a bipartisan coalition to help make that bridge and the economic benefits that come from that bridge a reality. As Michigan's next senator, I will continue to be an independent voice that Michigan middle-class families, small business owners, students, seniors, and veterans can count on. I want to continue my record of overcoming the partisanship and gridlock and delivering for Michigan in practical ways that will make a difference for the businesses and middle-class families that make our state strong. Thank you for listening and have a wonderful day.
Hello, my name is Chris Womhoff. I'm the U.S. Senate candidate for Michigan from the Green Party. I was born in Plainwell, Michigan. I lived here my whole life. I work in Kalamazoo and live in the Edison neighborhood. I think you should vote for me because I am not asking for your money. I'm asking for your vote. I don't want campaign money. I want you to give it to local causes. And I don't want you to believe in my ideas. I want to listen to yours. I want you to vote for me because a vote for me is a vote listening to the people like the Water Board in Detroit, like the DCATs in Detroit, like the Land Conservancy in Michigan. I network with local communities. I've been doing it for the last 3 years. I'm running for office to help do a better job of doing what I already do. If I'm elected, I want money out of politics. I'm going to push morally for all politicians to work on the minimum wage of their constituency. And if I'm elected, I will do so. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Stephen Boyle. I am the Green Party candidate for U.S. Congress in the 14th District of Michigan. A little bit of information about me. You may not see my name all that often. Unfortunately, our Green Party doesn't always get an awful lot of press. And I want you to know a little bit more about the Green Party. We're not just an environmental justice party. We also deal with an awful lot of civil rights and equal justice for all. What I wanted to talk to you about is my background a little bit so you understand who I am. I've been around corporate America doing information technology processing for business for about 20 years now. I'm a freelance photographer and web developer. I've been busy over the past few years with Detroit's communities that are in the most need, working on issues such as the water shutoffs, the pollution situation along the Detroit River, and I've also worked on situations where the voice of people is not being heard in government. One reason that I'm running for U.S. Congress is to see what we can do at a higher level to see how the changes can actually appear in our local government. There is something that's coming up really that I'm thrilled about, and that's addressing some of the mass transit needs in Detroit. I think that our workers need to be able to get to where they need to get to. Here in Farmington Hills area, mass transit is a distant cry from what it possibly could be. And I think that we can definitely change the infrastructure of the area and embrace greener technologies, including things like bike paths and walking trails that people can enjoy their environment, not just in a small area, but in a wider space. People can get back to going grocery shopping and walking a half mile to the shop if they want to. Right now it's very difficult with the way the roads are laid out and so forth. One of the things as far as jobs is concerned goes, and I realize that there's an awful lot of focus on jobs, what I'd like to say is the green technology jobs, those jobs that would change our energy and our living infrastructure, whether we're in residential homes or commercial buildings, could potentially generate thousands of new jobs and move us into a greener new future that would no longer have us so saddled with the burden of pollution that comes from our fossil fuel use. I believe that our education system has an opportunity to spark new minds and create radically different processes if we return to actually teaching people how things get to be where they are. My background is includes systems thinking in regards to information technology systems, and my community involvement has included engagement from situation of need through the legal and regulatory systems and moving toward solutions on the street. And I think that our intent is not enough. We actually need to be about doing some of the things that we say that are important in our lives. It means that people can break away from some of the traditional forms that we've adopted in our society right now that have grown bigger and bigger divides between us, and return more to community living and realizing that our localized needs can be satisfied by local talent. And it's just our responsibility to say, it's time for me to actually employ my neighbor, or it's time for me to move my purchasing behavior, for example, for food, into community gardens and growing things with each other. There's an awful lot of love and energy that can be shared together as we move into that kind of a community and cooperative environment. And thank you.
Hello, my name is James Young, and I'm running for State Senate District 11 as a Libertarian candidate. I am a U.S. Army veteran. I was born in Detroit in 1955, and I live in Farmington Hills. I'm running for this office because I want to bring Libertarian values to our state so that we can live in a free and prosperous state. The Libertarian Party follows the principle of personal responsibility and strives to achieve and maintain small, constitutionally limited government, the kind of government that our founding fathers intended for us to have. This is not just true at the federal level, but applies to state and local government as well. Each one of the two major parties tends to be power-driven. Thus, the people who lead these must actually have a psychological need for big government. Libertarians are not power-driven and only want small, constitutionally limited government and liberty for the people. Thus, libertarians have the greatest chance of actually achieving this objective. Now let's talk about the issues. First, there is the state budget and road repair issue. My ultimate goal is to eliminate the state income tax because it is the most intrusive of all taxes. Some states already have no income tax. In fiscal year 2012, it cost $27.8 billion to run Michigan, with 25% coming from state income tax. With a state population of just over 9.9 million people, this breaks down to $2,807.45 per year for every citizen in this state. Enough is enough. The real time for fiscal conservatism is now. If we could run Michigan on $21 billion per year, we could eliminate the state income tax without replacement. This wouldn't necessarily favor the wealthy either, because many of them use tax loopholes and actually pay less income tax than many others less well off. Regarding road repairs, this is something that we must admit that we really need. However, it is also true that our state gas tax revenue has been going to things other than road repair in Michigan. I have heard that Washington has even been taking some of it. Let's stop all of this and use this money only for road repair in Michigan. If necessary, we could raise the gas tax, but this probably won't be necessary. The politicians have most of us brainwashed into believing that we need every bit of the current state budget money to run Michigan. But that probably isn't true. As your state senator, I will be a watchdog for every opportunity to make reductions so that we can all have a state government that is as small and free from unnecessary regulation as possible. Regarding education, I don't think that we should spend any more money on education than we are now. Perhaps we can spend even less money on it. In fiscal year 2012, 45.2% of the budget was spent on education, by far more than everything else, which is probably typical of state budgets. Yes, education is important, but the current system already provides all that a student needs to learn. I believe that the real education problem is a motivational one rather than a financial one. Students who really want to learn will learn very readily, and this should even be a positive thing. Regarding healthcare, government should not even be in the healthcare business in the first place. We need free market solutions to healthcare. This general election on November 4th is, as I see it, about maintaining the mediocre status quo versus rising above this mediocrity for a truly free and prosperous society. Voting libertarian is the way. On November 4th, please vote, and please vote libertarian. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Christine Gregg, and I'm asking for your vote on November 4th to be your next state representative. Like many of you, I'm frustrated with our government, so I decided to run for office and be part of the solution. We need new people to represent us and fight for our values in Lansing. Since 2011, the governor and legislature have enacted policies that benefit only a few, promising that the rest will eventually benefit from the trickle-down effects of business prosperity. Well, it's been more than 3 years, and where are we? We are ranked fifth highest in unemployment. Michigan has 50 school districts in deficit, and $1 billion has been taken out of our classrooms. Seniors are taxed on their pensions, our roads are crumbling, and many rights, especially women's reproductive rights, have been taken away. Michigan's per capita income and income growth are the lowest of all Great Lakes states. To move Michigan forward, we need good public policy that works for everyone, not just for a few. This election is about putting people first. My personal background and business and community experiences are ideal for working for the people of Farmington and Farmington Hills. As the sixth of 12 siblings, I learned at an early age to work hard and respect others to make positive things happen. I've worked in corporate America, owned a successful technology business right here in Farmington Hills, and started and managed successful nonprofit organizations. I've met with local, state, and national leaders to advocate for children in public education. I served as the secretary of the Farmington Hills 2020 Jobs and Education Committee, and co-founded and managed our education foundation. I brought the school-to-prison pipeline discussion to our community, organized town hall meetings, and organized a suicide awareness forum in our schools. I'm also active in our local faith community, serving as a volunteer and lector at St. Alexander. I am a member of the Optimist Club, Sierra Club, League of Women Voters, Exemplar Club, and AAUW. I have lived, worked, and raised my family in Farmington Hills since 1990. My husband Bob and I have three sons. Alex and Andy are in college, and Bill is a senior at Farmington High School. As your next state representative, I will work to find a long-term solution to repairing and modernizing our roads and bridges. We must look at quality construction and maintenance practices, truck weights, diesel and gasoline rate parity, and new funding sources. We need to make sure the money we already collect is being used effectively and efficiently. I will also insist we adequately fund and support our public schools. We need to foster innovation by utilizing the skills and resources of our business community to bring more apprenticeship and mentoring opportunities to our students and workers. We need to support an education system that values fine arts, music, physical education, skilled trades, and foreign language as a complement to math, science, and language arts. We also need to overhaul our tax system to pay for state services in a more fair and balanced way between individuals and corporations. Under current Republican control, programs and services that support our seniors, communities, children, and the most vulnerable have been treated as optional line items that can be discarded to balance the budget after slashing corporate taxes. A fair and balanced budget that supports both business and people can be achieved, but it takes legislators from both parties to sit down and listen to each other and to the public when it comes to determining our state's top funding priorities. We need strong people who understand the difference between a hand up and a hand out. We need strong people who understand fairness and balance and will approach our state's challenges from this perspective, not from the viewpoint that everyone will eventually benefit. Getting the job done and serving my community have been my life's work. I've already knocked on 7,000 of your doors during this election. You tell me you are tired of the fighting. We have to start working together to move Michigan forward together. As your state representative, I promise to listen before I vote. Thank you for this opportunity to share my priorities with you. I ask for your support and vote on November 4th. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Richard Lerner, and I'm a Farmington Hills City Council member and a candidate for the State House of Representatives for Farmington and Farmington Hills. My wife and I bought land here in 1996 and built our home. We've raised our two children here and both attend Farmington Public Schools, and we've been actively involved in serving this community for the past two decades. This community is our home. As a city council member and former mayor pro tem, I have consistently worked hard to deliver the most services for your tax dollars. Michigan's economy has taken a big hit in the past decade, and that's taken a toll on property values, jobs, and our infrastructure. Turning this around demands experienced people in Lansing. We need someone with an understanding of the issues, the know-how to research viable options, the vision to implement solutions, and the experience and leadership to carry them out. We also need someone who will take a stand and focus on getting Michigan back on track. Someone who has turned down tens of thousands of dollars of special interest group offers to candidates and will represent the people of our two cities without being beholden to someone else. I am that candidate, and that's why 11 current and former mayors of Farmington and Farmington Hills, representing both sides of the aisle, have endorsed my campaign. As a council member, I've demonstrated common sense decision making and fiscal responsibility. I've challenged proposals for special interests, avoided partisan bickering, and focused on the greater good for our community. As an active volunteer in our community, I have a proven track record of organizing, leading, and improving efficiency on many impactful service projects. I've been not just a member, but a leader for numerous community service organizations, including the Goodfellows, the Exemplar Club, the Optimist and Junior Optimist programs, and the Interagency Council. These agencies support at-risk children, seniors, families, and over 30 other charitable and nonprofit organizations in our community. I've been a scout leader, a soccer coach, and president of the middle school ski club. I was the founder of the F2H Fit Challenge, focusing on improving health and wellness in our community, and enlisted the support of 9 other organizations to support the program in our two cities. Most recently, I was appointed to the enforcement board of the Beaumont Health System merger. Part of my role there is to ensure that the promises made for improvements and investments in Botsford Hospital, our largest employer, and our community, are kept following the merger. As a small business owner, I've felt the effects of the slump in Michigan's economy. I have a vested interest in helping Michigan promote economic growth, gain better control of spending, and create new jobs. Over the course of my career, I've managed 8-figure divisions of Fortune 100 companies and help businesses to reorganize and operate efficiently, whether it's downsizing, right-sizing, and expanding in various economic climates. I have the experience. In 1993, I left the corporate world to start my own small business. I've written my own paycheck for the past 21 years, and I've started 4 businesses, 3 of which continue to operate today. I'm confident that my background and these skill sets will transfer well to the role of state representative. As a parent with 2 children in Farmington Public Schools, I want to return more local control to our schools and provide a consistent source of funding. I've witnessed the impact of increasing budget cuts and felt the effects of the drastic decision-making resulting in lower test scores. We need to fix the formulas for education funding and restore the former quality levels of our schools. As a longtime resident, I recognize that we need to dedicate funding to address the decay in our roads and bridges and find a way to reverse the decline in our infrastructure. Our current level of funding is simply not keeping pace with our roads. We must provide additional dedicated funding, or our road conditions will continue to decline. Lansing is filled with people who have good intentions. What we need are people who have the know-how to solve our statewide problems and a track record of leading positive change on a larger scale. Leaders who understand how to spend tax dollars responsibly. I have that experience. In fact, I'm the only candidate who has that experience. If you'd like to learn more about my run for the State House, please visit my campaign website at www.richardlerner.net. If you like what you see, I hope you'll come out and support me on November 4th. Aside from the state representative race, we also have a very important local road millage proposal on the ballot, and you can learn more about that at www.fhgov.com. Thanks for your time, and have a great day.
My name is Dr. Cassandra Alberge, and I'm running for re-election to the State Board of Education. The State Board is constitutionally charged with general oversight over public education in Michigan. In addition, we're responsible for hiring the State Superintendent of Public Instruction. We're made up of 8 members, with 2 seats up for statewide election every 2 years. I've served on the board for the past 8 years. I currently serve as the Vice President of the Board, and I chair the Board's Legislative Committee. I'm also a Vice President at Macomb Community College. So literally every day of my life is devoted to public education at one level or another. As a product of Michigan's public education system, a first-generation college graduate, and now a higher ed administrator, I know firsthand the value of a quality education. I'm running for re-election because Michigan needs strong voices in Lansing who believe in the importance of public education and will fight legislative efforts to dismantle our local schools. As a board member, I have advocated for policies that improve quality, including expanding early childhood education, and have led the fight to increase transparency and accountability. Unfortunately, there's much that needs to be done. Michigan needs a common sense strategy that reflects current realities. 20 years ago, Michigan voters approved Proposal A, a public school funding model that transferred fiscal responsibility from local districts to the state. Now, each school receives a standard per pupil foundation allowance based on current enrollment or student headcount. The system works well as long as there's a stable enrollment. At the same time that voters were approving Proposal A, the state began experimenting with school choice, namely in the form of charter schools. Today, we have over 300 charter and cyber schools in Michigan. We also have more for-profit run charters than any state in the nation. Nearly 80% of our charter schools are run by for-profit management companies. In the last 10 years, our state has seen a decline in enrollment of nearly 200,000 students. At the same time, we've seen a net gain of over 160 new charter schools. In other words, while we're losing students, we're expanding infrastructure. This is completely unsustainable and has led to unstable school budgets, as districts no longer can anticipate how many students they will have from year to year, and thus cannot anticipate their annual budget. As a result, last year, we saw 55 school districts, or 1 in 10, in deficit, the highest we've ever seen. 2 districts were dissolved, and many others had to make painful cuts that will negatively impact student achievement. Unfortunately, this growth has not led to increased student achievement. We all want high-quality schools, and for those that are struggling to improve. But it's very difficult to improve when you're operating in such an unstable environment. In order to improve our local schools, we need to stabilize the platform in which they operate. Then we can invest in those things we know work, such as lower class sizes, expanded early childhood education, and supporting effective teachers. This isn't about ideology. It's just common sense. As a state board member, I will continue to explore improvements to both our funding model as well as our structure, because Michigan students and taxpayers deserve no less. We need a common sense strategy that will give all our young people the tools and resources they need to be successful in college, career, and their communities. To learn more about my campaign, please visit my website at www.cassandraalbridge.com, and I hope I can count on your support this November. Thank you.
I am Sherry A. Wells, the candidate of the Green Party of Michigan for the State Board of Education. Contrary to popular misunderstanding, the Green Party is not a one-issue party. We are concerned not only with the natural environment, but also with the green in your pockets. We are concerned with fairness in how everyone is treated. We are concerned with grassroots democracy, not the corporate and top-down government that for the most part now exists. And we are concerned with nonviolence. These are the first of the 10 pillars upon which our platforms are based. After I read those first 10, I thought, I could live in a world like this. So I want to be part of an organized movement in that direction. All of these concerns apply to our schools. Charter schools are in Michigan, but not in all states, a corporate and top-down government takeover run mostly by for-profit companies. I was forming a proposal for a grassroots solution and learned that House Bill 5268 has exactly that. It is in the House of Representatives Education Committee. Contact your representatives, Vicki Barnett and Hugh Crawford, now to get it out of there, onto the floor, and passed before they all go home on December 18 and it dies. Make it your democracy. We walk our talk. The Green Party and its candidates refuse corporate contributions. We accept donations only from individuals, only from you. Common Core is another important school issue. Corporations are supporting that, and it is supporting them. It is important to assess a child's achievement, but no child learns in a vacuum, only in a decent physical and home environment. The House bill next in number to HB 5268, that's 5269, lists many factors beyond the control of classroom teachers that affect each student's ability to obtain the education presented. My daughter told me that after every anti-bullying school assembly, the bullies had about 2 weeks worth of ideas they hadn't previously thought of. For that, I propose a culture of respect. Montgomery County, Maryland has such a program that pervades the entire school government. That kind of culture will grow fairness while it reduces violence in a positive approach. Fairness is vital so that all of our students are able to get the basic education in order to achieve what each is most capable of achieving. And I am already working as a volunteer organizer towards literacy. It is not only Detroit that has that problem, but other cities and rural areas in Michigan as well. When I worked for the Department of Social Services, an ADC father, staying with his family instead of deserting them, was studying for his high school diploma. His children gathered their homework around him at the dining room table to be like the big person in their lives. Achieving literacy cannot be only a two-hour weekly session, and I admire those who volunteer for those one-on-one sessions. We can learn from others around the world, not only from Finland, which the Common Core holds up as an example, as different as it is from the United States, but in 1961, Cuba went from 27% to 95% literacy in 1 year. We can do that. Literacy reduces poverty and crime and grows an appreciation for education. That gives our children a healthier learning environment and lets teachers teach. I earned a degree in education from Michigan State University after completing 2 years at Grand Rapids Junior College. There was an alleged teacher surplus, so a few years later I earned a law degree at Wayne State University. Since then, I have taught every chance I got in evening classes and by public speaking about various subjects. I raised 2 children in our public schools, so I'm familiar with the strengths and weaknesses of our schools. During a year when we lived in Detroit, my son had some amazing middle school teachers. In my current town of Ferndale, my daughter appreciated the diversity in her student body, as well as the non-academic classes, which kept her interest while she struggled with some of the others. Please know that the State Board of Education website is packed with information, videotaped meetings, and materials. I want to hear from you before and after you elect me. Thank you.
I'm Jonathan Tade Williams, and I'm running for the Michigan State Board of Education. I've been teaching American government and political science now for almost 20 years as a community college professor, And during that time, I've witnessed a decline in the readiness of students as they've come to my classroom after they've completed their K-12 experience. And that concerns me. And I know it concerns the majority of Michiganians as well. It concerns me so much as an educator and father of a school-age son that I've endeavored to join the State Board of Education to do what I can to turn the tide and assist in Michigan's comeback. My campaign website, parentdriveneducation.com, has enough information and background about me and more than I could ever get around to in this short snippet. When you go there, you'll see that I'm a strong proponent of school choice for parents, that I believe that we should allow parents to have the decisions that affect their child's education. And so much so that I believe in that, that I've decided to run for the State Board of Education, but I've also joined a charter school back in Jackson, Michigan. Jackson Preparatory and Early College offers parents a viable choice. And you also see in the website, Parent-Driven Education, that I believe strongly in local control and allowing the local school boards, administrators, and teachers to do the job that they were elected, appointed, or hired to do. I believe very strongly in that education system should be local, and I fear and cringe that it's drifting further away from that local control and towards Washington, D.C. We don't need our system to become just another federal program administered by the state. You know, we should all cringe at that notion. You know, one doesn't have to look far to witness the inefficiency of Washington, D.C. Ask your kids about their school lunch program. You know, ask their teachers about Common Core or their testing requirements. Ask the administrators about the hours of work they do just filing paperwork. You know what? Better still, ask your doctor about Washington, D.C. You know, so I'm running to ensure that our precious State Board of Education system does not follow in the path that has become the debacle of our healthcare system. Choice, accountability, through local control with parents in charge, that's our campaign. And I have degrees in political science and public administration. I've been a Michigan Political Leadership Program Fellow. I've worked in the Michigan Senate, been elected twice to the Jackson County Board of Commissioners. I'm happily married. I have a great school-age son, and I'm asking for your support. I'm asking for your vote for me, Jonathan Tade Williams, for State Board of Education come November. I appreciate your consideration. I appreciate your time. Thank you.
Michigan voters, my name is Joe Sanger. I'm a retired certified public accountant and the Taxpayers Party candidate for the University of Michigan Board of Regents. For those of you not acquainted with the Taxpayers Party, we differ from Democrats and Republicans in that we represent the taxpayers and not the tax users. On university boards, we will represent the tuition payers and not the tuition users. The Northwest Ordinance of 1787 and the Michigan Constitution of 1963 both provide religion, morality, and knowledge being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind. Schools and the means of education shall forever be encouraged. When I was a freshman at the University of Michigan in the autumn of 1955, the full-time in-state undergraduate tuition rate at the College of Literature, Science, and the Arts was $90 a semester. Today, the comparable charge is $6,909, an increase of 7,577%. At the same time, the Consumer Price Index, as measured by the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis, has increased from 26.8 to 236.2, an increase of 781%. Over the past 59 years, University of Michigan tuition has increased by 9.70 times the rate of inflation, an astounding and totally unconscionable price increase. How this was done is explained in my August 1997 Michigan Taxpayer article, Higher Education in America, Ripping Off the Kids for Fun and Profit. That article is on my website, www.joesanger.com. That's www.joesanger.com. You ought to read it. Had the University of Michigan's tuition increased only at the rate of inflation, today's tuition would be $793 a semester, a reasonable fee. Here's what I propose. The University of Michigan is still using the same method of teaching that it used in 1817. Students are required to live on or near campus and meet for class in lecture halls, accommodating a limited number of students. It's time for the University of Michigan to get out of the horse and buggy age and come into the 21st century. Today's technology permits online instruction of an unlimited number of students, each learning at an in-home computer. The university can provide lecture tapes licensed from the world's best instructors. Students can report to testing centers in major cities for a midterm and a final examination in each course. Students who pass their exams can receive college credit for those courses. Students who meet the required course requirements can earn their degrees, all without ever setting foot on a University of Michigan campus. No expensive admission procedures are required. Anyone who pays the $800 a semester tuition fee can be admitted. Every student can determine on his own if he is qualified for admission and prove it by passing his exams. The university does not need blocks of residence halls, lecture halls, an army of highly paid professionals, and of admissions eligibility determination administrators. Educational quality can be improved and costs dramatically reduced. By learning at home, each student can save $10,000 a year in university residence hall fees. At $800 a semester, each student can save an additional $12,218 a year in tuition. If the University of Michigan is the first to implement this program, I believe that tens of thousands of new students will want to enroll. If you believe that it is time to bring the University of Michigan into the 21st century, that it is time to stop paying an outrageous price for your children's education, then I ask that you vote for me and my fellow taxpayers candidate, Christine Schwartz, for the University of Michigan Board of Regents. Send them a message.
My name is Kathy White. I am the chair of the University of Michigan Board of Regents. I am running for re-election, and I ask for your vote. The state of Michigan continues to transform from a traditional manufacturing economy to a knowledge-based economy. Higher education is a critical piece of this transformation. The University of Michigan must continue to build a bridge between education, science, industry, and government to create the synergy needed to sustain and improve the quality of higher education in this state. The University of Michigan is well positioned to translate knowledge to solve problems of general public interest so that many societal needs can be met. My background gives me a solid foundation to lead the University of Michigan through these changing times. I have a Bachelor's of Science and Engineering degree in Electrical Engineering from Princeton University, a JD from the University of Washington, a Master of Laws in Intellectual Property Law from George Washington University, and a Master's degree in Strategic Studies from the U.S. Army War College. I'm a professor of law at Wayne State University Law School, a registered patent attorney, Fulbright Senior Scholar, White House Fellow, and a Lieutenant Colonel in the U.S. Army Reserves in the Judge Advocate General's Corps. As the relative amount of state funding declines, policies to keep the University of Michigan affordable must be in place. Keeping the university affordable enables students from all backgrounds with different perspectives to enrich the academic environment through their engagement with each other. During my tenure on the board, the University of Michigan has increased financial aid commensurate with any tuition increases for in-state residents. In the current capital campaign, Victors for Michigan, the University of Michigan has committed to raise $1 billion for financial aid to significantly expand the university's capacity to provide more scholarships. This endowment ensures the University of Michigan's commitment to financial aid is sustainable throughout generations. Service members who have served in Iraq and Afghanistan are now returning to further their education. It is important that the University of Michigan has policies in place to maximize the use of veterans' benefits. This is why I spearheaded the move to give all veterans in-state tuition. This enables veterans to take full advantage of their veterans benefits and maximize their funding level. In these times of limited state and federal funding, it is paramount that the quality of education at the University of Michigan is not jeopardized, but energized and enhanced. Regents are elected statewide, so if you are registered to vote in the state of Michigan, you can vote for me, Kathy White, for Regent of the University of Michigan. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Terry Link, and I'm running for the Michigan State University Board of Trustees. I recently retired from MSU after nearly 30 years. I've worked across the institutional mission in the classroom, as a librarian, as a founding director of the national award-winning Office of Campus Sustainability, and as a member of numerous university governance committees. I have worked closely with administration and faculty, with staff, and with students. I seek this unpaid position because I strongly believe that my experience, knowledge, and dedication to building a better future for all of us will help MSU chart a new course as a public university. MSU was founded to help its citizens further their personal development while contributing to the public good. While reduced state support for public higher education over the past two or three decades has been a tragedy, MSU and other universities have become hooked on the myth that education should be run as a business. This market-based model, driven by growth of facilities, of the number of students, and of salaries, especially at the high end, has led to higher cost and diminished the very purpose of a college education. I would be a voice for frugality, not by cutting wages and benefits for those at the low end of the wage scale, or by driving up tuition costs, but by capping the growth in administrative and other high-wage salaries. I would continue to seek, as I did while sustainability director, a greater reduction in energy consumption and cost. I would also recommend that the university replace computers, equipment, and other furnishings less often. But we must push the state government to reinstate funding for education at all levels to enable us to meet our mission and remain accessible. While the world around us is besieged with environmental threats, skyrocketing inequality, and social and political unraveling, approximately 10,000 new students arrive at MSU each fall, and almost that many more move on by the end of the academic year to places across Michigan and the globe. Our graduates become citizens in many kinds of places, some urban, some rural, some well off, and some beset by challenges. In so doing, they engage in these communities not simply in the careers they choose, but as citizens actively shaping these places and determining the quality of life for all. Are we providing our students with the understanding and tools they need to be the leaders the world needs? Do they have a basic and sound understanding of what the natural world that sustains life? Have they learned about and experienced how groups can come to agreement around complex issues when there are divergent views of how to move ahead? Do they recognize our interdependence and the ideal of a common good? These are the fundamental questions that trustees must look to answer as they approve budgets and policies and hire the next president of the university. I'm ready to meet this challenge. I have been a leader in higher education nationally within both sustainability and library arenas, and have been recognized for that leadership as one of three library superstars by College and Research Libraries, as a senior fellow with the U.S. Partnership for Education for Sustainable Development, and as the invited commencement speaker at Oakland Community College's graduation in 2010. I have been equally active and effective as the executive director of the Greater Lansing Food Bank, as an elected county commissioner, and as a board member for numerous nonprofit organizations. Perhaps even more important than my experience and knowledge is my steadfast commitment to increasing participation, to strengthening democratic process, to promoting transparency, and to creating environments where ideas can be shared and new possibilities born. MSU should be such a model for the state, the nation, and the world. You can find much more information about my experience and background, my 32 platform suggestions, and a list of endorsees and testimonials at our website, www.gogreengolink.org, or visit us on Facebook at GoGreenGoLink. Thanks very much. Vote November the 4th.
Hi, my name is Jeff Sayakwa. I'm running for the Board of Trustees of Michigan State University. Our state constitution allows us to elect Michigan State University, University of Michigan, and Wayne State University's boards. The other 12 public universities are appointed by the governor. These positions are very important as they set the policies, budgets, and procedures for university. I believe in today's environment, college tuition has skyrocketed faster than health care. That's alarming, especially at a time when residents can ill afford to pay more. What's more important is our students are only graduating 31% in 4 years as a national average. That is a horrible, horrible statistic. Each student that does not graduate in 4 years holds a place for another student. Additionally, public universities in Michigan have taken more out-of-state students and out-of-country students, therefore not enabling our students to get in first. We as a taxpayer should have the right to any student that meets the criteria to get into our universities first, and I will fight for that each and every single day. Additionally, budgets must be handled in a better manner on a line item budget. Classes that aren't producing, majors that aren't producing jobs must be eliminated. College board and tuition must be looked at every single item to enable us to streamline costs, not necessarily cut costs, and become more efficient. My accounting background from graduating Michigan State in 1982 and my real estate career has forced me to live by a budget. I am now the father of one college freshman, another student on the way. And I know that the worst thing could happen is spending a fortune for my son or daughter to go to college, and worse yet, coming out in debt, and yes, without a job. At Michigan State University, for example, 89% of the students that graduate agriculture get a job or go on to grad school, yet only 60% of agriculture jobs are filled. That is a place we must invest more money. Additionally, our automotive industry is having to hire engineers from out of state and out of the country. We are the automotive capital of the world, and yes, we want to reinvent ourselves, but we must do a better job at STEM. Michigan State University has done a great job, but we need to do better. And we can and we will do better. Similarly, if a child knows what their education wants to be in, why not have courses that enable a student to graduate in 3 years instead of 4 years, enabling them to get into the workforce earlier and saving a year's education? Additionally, certain classes that don't mean anything should be eliminated, and we should look at maybe reducing the amount of credits to graduate. Once again, saving money, getting us out earlier. Students that meet all these criteria must be going to Michigan State University first before out-of-state students or foreign students. Additionally, we want to work together with all the other public universities because we all have the same problems, and we can and must do that together with the idea of saving money, number two, and producing jobs for the 21st century. We must enable corporations and other factions of our economy to work together with the university to do research to enable students to graduate, get jobs, and once again lower our debt. $1.2 trillion of our federal deficit is unpaid student loans. College has become another big business. College should be an education, not a business. And once again, our students come first. I'm Jeff Sakwa. Go green, go white, go MSU. I would appreciate your support on November 4th. Thank you very much.
Hello, my name is Satish Jasti. I am a candidate for the Wayne State University Board of Governors. I'll be on the statewide ballot this November 4th. I will tell you a little bit about myself before telling you why I'm running for this position and why you should vote for me. I came to this country in 1975 from India as a 16-year-old immigrant and have lived in Southeast Michigan continuously since then. My parents came here before me so that my dad can earn his PhD at the University of Detroit. Once my dad got his degree, he got a job at City of Detroit and sponsored me and my brothers to come to this country so that we could have a better education and a better economic future. My parents knew that a college education was key to our success. They taught us that if we can get a good education and work hard, we will be successful. It proved to be true for me and my brothers. One of my brothers is a PhD in engineering, one is an MD, and one has a bachelor's in engineering. They all have successful careers in their chosen fields. I graduated from Wayne State with an accounting degree, got a great job at the Federal Reserve Bank in downtown Detroit, and went on to do my MBA part-time at the University of Chicago. I've been a commercial banker and an entrepreneur. I founded a business-oriented bank, community bank, in Southeast Michigan, and lent millions to small businesses during the great financial crisis from 2007 to 2010, when the big banks stopped lending in Michigan. I'm married to my wife, Dr. Sri Jasti, for 27 years, and we have two daughters, ages 24 and 17, currently studying in our universities. We are a family that believes college education can transform lives for the better, and are living proof of that. So why do I want to run for Wayne State University Board of Governors? I care deeply about my alma mater, and I want to help Wayne State achieve excellence. I went to two city universities, and understand the unique challenges and opportunities faced by students at those kind of universities. Wayne State has the worst graduation and retention rates among Michigan's 15 public universities. Instead of controlling the spiraling cost of running Wayne State, and in order to make up for dropping enrollment, Wayne State Board started to compete with local community colleges and started accepting students that really do not belong at a major research university. In other words, Wayne State dropped its admission standards to keep up its enrollment to bring in more revenue. When the enrollment still did not keep up with the costs of running Wayne State, the board started increasing tuition. Wayne State has the fastest rate of tuition increases in the state. 2 years ago, the board increased tuition by almost 10%. In 2013, the board, without understanding the costs involved, signed an unheard of 8-year contract with the union. What happens if we have another recession? Wayne still has to pay the increases year after year, written into that contract, while other organizations can freeze their wages to cope with the economy. While at Wayne State, the board will just increase tuition to pay their ever-increasing costs. They know that most of those tuition dollars come from student loans, which are becoming a huge problem for our country and our kids. We need to elect people that have business and entrepreneurial backgrounds to help Wayne State cut costs, increase revenues, not by increasing tuition, but by increasing enrollment, by recruiting more international and out-of-state students who pay more than in-state students, but not at the cost of turning away eligible in-state students. We need to increase the university's reputation by increasing the worst graduation and retention rates. This will in turn attract more qualified students and professors. The better professors will bring in more research dollars through grants. If properly managed, Wayne State can be, for the city of Detroit and Southeast Michigan, what University of Michigan Ann Arbor has become for the city of Ann Arbor and Washtenaw County. Wayne State spends about $1 billion annually in our economy. We need to balance the board at Wayne State. Most of the board members at Wayne are either former union officials, educators, attorneys, or Democratic Party political staffers. And now the Democratic Party nominated two more attorneys to stand for the election for election at Wayne State. I'm a businessman, a banker, an entrepreneur, and someone that comes from a family that is dedicated to higher education, and know what a young person can achieve with a college degree. I urge you to elect me, Satish Jasti, for Wayne State University Board of Governors this November. Thank you.
My name is Marilyn Kelly. I'm a candidate for the Wayne State University Board of Governors. On November 4, when you vote, you will be asked to choose two people from a list of 11 to sit on Wayne's board. I'd like you to pick me as one of your choices. Here's why. I have years of experience as a board member. For example, you elected me twice to the Michigan State Board of Education, where I served for 12 years, 2 years as board president. Also, I served on the board of Channel 56 Public Television and the State Bar of Michigan Foundation. But most importantly, you elected me twice to the Michigan Court of Appeals and twice to the Michigan Supreme Court, where I served a combined 24 years, 2 years as Chief Justice. That experience, especially my years on the Supreme Court, gave me a valuable education in board work. And that's because the court is a lot like the board at Wayne in that it oversees and directs a huge operation. The court oversees all the state courts. The Wayne Board of Governors oversees the university. In addition to my experience as a board member, I'd like you to know about my long and close association with Wayne State University. Obviously, people who ask you to elect them to the board should be able to demonstrate that their interest in the university did not spring up just yesterday. In my case, I graduated with honors from Wayne's Law School. I've served for many years on its Board of Visitors. The law school has honored me with an honorary Doctor of Laws degree, and the university has awarded me its Distinguished Alumni Award. Since I left the court at the end of 2012, I've taught at the law school, which has been good enough to name me its Distinguished Jurist in Residence. Today, I co-chair the law school's part of the university's multi-million dollar capital fundraising drive. If you elect me to the Board of Governors, you may be certain that I will actively pursue several objectives. I will work to keep student tuition low. An undergraduate resident student living on the university's campus spends about $21,500 per year, a lot of money. But think of this, Wayne is among the least expensive of Michigan's public institutions. I will work to keep tuition down. Also, diversity of the student body is important. Wayne's students come from nearly every state in the union and from 60 countries. 36% of the undergraduates are minorities, and another 11% are international. I think this diversity benefits everyone at the university by better reflecting society and offering varied backgrounds and perspectives. I will work to keep the student body diverse. Finally, I will work for excellence in Wayne's academic programs. Students are entitled to full value for their tuition money. They should get an education that will both enrich their future lives and enable them to earn a good living. I'm so impressed with the students at Wayne. They're bright and eager and fun to teach. I've developed a class called Access to Justice that teaches law students about what's called the justice gap. The justice gap is the gap between the number of lawyers who are available to handle cases for people with the money to pay them and the number of lawyers who work for the poor. I feel strongly that it's important that our law schools educate lawyers willing to work for the poor and the underprivileged, and yes, even for people with a living income, but who can't afford the price of a lawyer to represent them in court in a civil matter. Because of my concerns about the justice gap, I've endowed a permanent scholarship at Wayne's Law School for students who are devoted to practicing public service law when they graduate. If you decide to vote for me, there are two ways you can do it. You can vote a straight ticket for the Democratic Party. That will not only automatically cast a vote for me, it will cast a vote for Dana Thompson, an excellent candidate who is a law school teacher at the University of Michigan and was formerly a teacher at Wayne's Law School. If you don't vote a straight ticket, you can choose Dana and me when you get to the part of the ballot entitled Wayne State University Board of Governors. Meanwhile, you can find me on the web at MarilynKellyForWSU.com. I look forward to serving you once again.
Hello there, I'm Mark Joseph Sosnowski. I'm a candidate for the Wayne State University Board of Governors, nominated by the U.S. Taxpayer Party of Michigan, the state affiliate of the National Constitution Party. The Constitution Party just wants the government to follow the Constitution. If you think that's the way things should be, I invite you to read the party platform at www.constitutionparty.com. Here you will find people who are truly pro-life, pro-gun, and pro-traditional family, who are in favor of securing the borders, and who are not ashamed to thank the Lord for the blessings in our land. You might be interested to know I have 20 years' experience in property management, mostly in the apartment business, and also 30 years of volunteer effort in the field of bioethics. I am campaigning on three basic issues. First, to work for the end of inhumane treatment of dogs in the Wayne State University Research Labs, where there has been ongoing protests of tortuous treatment of dogs, some of whom could be somebody's lost pet, undergoing experimental procedures to gather scientific research, which has been shown to have questionable value in the medical care of humans. If your pet was lost, sent to a pound and sold to a research scientist, would you deem it appropriate for the university to accept grant awards of funding to test your pet to a painful state of exhaustion, then destroy it for no good purpose other than to win research dollars? If you love animals, find my name on the ballot and vote for me. Second, I will work to prevent the implementation of Common Core education standards in the Wayne State University curriculum, and in particular with regard to the program of the International Baccalaureate degree, which is a tool of the United Nations to diminish U.S. sovereignty, along with other U.N. protocols of Agenda 21, taking our country another step closer to the New World Order. If you're a patriot and you agree, for instance, that U.S. military commanders must not ever be subject to the orders of the U.N., then find my name on the ballot and vote for me. Third, looking at a bigger, broader purpose, realize that the American education system has become a tool of the progressive modernist mindset with the central theme that there is no objective truth. Is it any wonder that politicians are known as liars? In their defense, politicians likely do not even know when they are lying because the mindset that dismisses objective truth. What such liars fail to realize is that objective truth is the reality because nobody likes to be lied to. When the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, he said for us to know the truth, and the truth will set us free. His opposition has been working all these centuries to turn that around, and now we have progressive modernists tell us to give them liberty, and they will tell us what is true. Take a look at the French Revolution, the Bolsheviks, Red China. Rather than follow the golden rule, they took over by force and disguised tyranny as liberty. It's a lie, designed to give them ultimate control in what one wise world leader labeled the tyranny of relativism. And before you go thinking that these attributes are not in the purview of the Board of Governors, I invite you to read the Wayne State University mission statement to be an urban institute of research and create knowledge. Please pause to ponder that and compare it to the documents of our founding fathers who noted truth to be self-evident. You see, in a subtle way, the powers that be will define your world, remove God-given rights, and create a new class of slavery unless you move to stop it. So, find my name on the ballot, Mark Joseph Sosnowski, and vote for me.
Hello, I'm Dana Thompson. Thank you, voters of Southeast Michigan, for the opportunity to talk briefly about why we must fight to ensure that our children are educated. This is why I'm running for the Wayne State University Board of Governors in the November election, because I believe it is time to have someone who will fight for a quality education and ensure that our students who enroll at Wayne not only get the education they need, but also are able to graduate. As a university teacher, I know firsthand what it means and what it will take to bring this to fruition. I've seen in the classroom when I first taught at Wayne State Law School the challenges our students and faculty face in ensuring a meaningful education. Where I teach now at the University of Michigan Law School, I see how our students can excel when they're given the tools and the resources necessary. I am running on a vision that is inclusive and will not only help renew America's promise to its young people, but also address issues of disparity in enrollment and opportunities. The Wayne State University Board of Governors needs someone who understands firsthand the struggle in the classroom and the school-student relationship. And I will represent that if you give me the opportunity to serve you as a member of the Wayne State University Board of Governors in this election. Public education is important to our enhancement as a region, and I want to make sure that Wayne State enhances the value of public education by becoming a voice for you in this region. I ask for your vote on Election Day this November 4th to safeguard an important value to our children, the right to an empowering education. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Marcia Gershenson, and I am one of your county commissioners. I represent District 13. I'm the incumbent, and District 13 goes from Orchard Lake west to Hagerty, from 14 Mile to 10 Mile, and then I zigzag around on Orchard Lake around 10 Mile. It was part of the gerrymandering that went on a couple years ago. But I've really gotten to know Farmington Hills, and I think it's a wonderful community. I want to tell you a little bit about myself. I started in the nonprofit world. I'm one of the founders of Gilda's Club. So I've learned a lot about starting something from the grassroots up and how to manage budgets. I then moved into community service where I worked in the schools, and I segued into public service. And I've been on the county commission for a few years, and I'd like to stay. So that's why I'm here to tell you what some of the things I've accomplished. Some of the achievements I'm most proud of is I started a women's advisory board. And last year we had our first event, which was a women's veterans event. And we look forward to having many more events that highlight the needs of women in our county. I also participated in some gun safety panels, and this was a bipartisan study. I'm a strong believer of working together with both sides of the aisle, and I do practice that. Our gun safety panels were in support of the Second Amendment, but we're also trying to look at how we can keep our residents safe. I am also very interested in our seniors. It's the fastest growing demographic in our community, and I want to make sure seniors that want to age at home can stay at home and still have access to so many of the services our county offers. Another big issue for me are our roads, and I'm sure they're an issue for you too. And as long as our state remains paralyzed and is unable to help our local communities, I think the time is now for local communities to step up and find their own solutions. I've done this with some other communities, so I look forward to working on it with yours. Another big issue is water. We're right now negotiating on the water authority that will probably most likely be established in Oakland County, and it will affect your water rates. So I want you to know that I'm here to represent you to make sure that you have the highest quality water and that your rates remain low. So I hope some of the things I've talked about with you today will convince you to vote for me on November 4th and return me to be your county commissioner. Thank you so much, and remember to vote for Marcia Gershenson.
Hello, my name is Gene Yee, and I'm the Republican candidate for Oakland County Commissioner District 13. District 13 includes the western portion of Farmington Hills from 14-mile to 10-mile roads from Drake to Halsted Roads, with a few additional precincts west of Farmington Road and north of I-696. I was born and raised in Detroit, and I have lived the American dream. I received my master's in engineering from the University of Michigan, retired from Chrysler Corporation, and now am an owner of a consulting firm. I am married and a father of two wonderful daughters. My wife and I are founding and current members of a nonprofit charitable 501c3 organization with over 250 members and with two affiliated branches. I have many years of state and federal government regulatory experience. This candidacy is an opportunity for me to give back to our community, which has been so good to us. I bring to the county commissioners engineering knowledge and discipline, whereas my opponent cannot. I will, one, maintain Oakland County's excellent bond rating by careful review of the budget. Many of our subdivisions in our district are approaching the age where the street and storm water drains need to be rebuilt. Repairs are funded by special assessments. With excellent bond rating, the interest on the borrowed funds lowers the cost to the homeowners. Two, we are fast approaching winter again, and many of our roads are still in disrepair. My engineering discipline will help the commissioners to evaluate the best cost-effective road repair technology to get more miles of roads repaired within the budget. I applaud the tentative agreement with the Detroit Water and Sewerage Department, but we need to look at alternatives to DWSD for wastewater treatment. Again, my engineering discipline will help guide the commissioners toward the best option to keep our wastewater costs under control. Three, I support the Governor Snyder's initiative for foreign investment using the EB-5 visa program. According to the Wall Street Journal, 85% of the applicants are Chinese. Being Chinese, I have a better chance to attract these companies to the economically depressed areas of Oakland County. More jobs and opportunities for us. As a senior citizen, I represent the needs of our seniors in our community. We will keep the programs that serve our seniors well and discard those that are marginal. If elected, I promise to do my very best representing the needs of our district. I would appreciate your support. Yes, it takes more time to split ticket vote, but the few extra minutes you spend will be beneficial to you and our district. Like you, my concerns led me to run for this office. I covet your support and vote this November. Thank you for watching and being concerned for our community.
Hello, I'm Bill Dwyer, your County Commissioner for the 14th District. It is my honor to be your voice in Oakland County government. As you consider your vote this November, I ask for the opportunity to continue to serve and build on a positive record of results. After nearly 50 years of experience in law enforcement, I understand what matters most and am not afraid to speak my mind. People want less partisan nonsense and political games. Difficult problems aren't going to be solved by finger pointing and excuses. We can accomplish a lot more if we focus on solutions. I worked on this spirit on your behalf in county government, and it's getting results. In the wake of the senseless violence in Sandy Hook, I went to work to make sure we were doing everything in our power to avoid a tragedy in Oakland County. My committee held extensive public hearings and gathered expert testimony. A comprehensive bipartisan plan of action is underway to keep us safe. Law enforcement, school leaders, and mental health professionals have joined together to work on solutions. Republicans and Democrats are teaming up to spread the word. In Washington and Lansing, we have nothing but gridlock on this issue. Oakland County recently won a national award for attacking gun violence. Leadership can make a difference. I am proud of my record of smart spending and good government strategies in county government. Balanced budgets 3 years in advance, capping employee benefits, low tax rates, and investments in growing job sectors is setting Oakland County apart from the crowd. Oakland County is leading the region in job growth, with an estimated 40,000 new jobs added by 2015. Home sales are up by more than 9%, and the number of foreclosures have plummeted. The county is rebounding from one of the worst economic periods in our history. There is more work to be done, and I am committed to fight for you. Our roads are in horrible condition. A third of the roads in Oakland County are in poor or worse condition, according to experts. This is a huge cost to each of us in terms of wear on our vehicles, time lost in traffic, and also in terms of lost investments in our economy. We must see less talk and more action. I am fighting to make sure every road dollar possible gets back to our community. With your support, I can continue this work and do more. I ask for your vote this November to build a brighter future for Oakland County as your county commissioner. Thank you.
I'm Gerald Skinner, a native Michigander who originally hails from downriver Allen Park. I'm a graduate of St. Francis Gabrini High School, attended Henry Ford Community College, and graduated from both Wayne County Community College and Wayne State University. I was employed by Ford Motor Company as a production worker and a production supervisor. I then decided to go in a different direction. An apprenticeship opportunity with Electrical Workers Local 58 was that direction, which provided me a 33-year career. We can't wait for Lansing to address our road and infrastructure needs. The Republican state government priorities fall between wolf hunting and women's reproductive rights. In Oakland County, we have the valuable asset of a AAA credit rating. I propose, number one, use this AAA credit rating to issue bonds to start critical repair projects. Our AAA credit rating will enable us to obtain a reasonable interest rate. Number two, the entire board should hire a full-time road commissioner under civil service rules. This person must have strong civil engineering or construction management background. This person will serve until the 2016 elections. This candidate can choose and run on the political party of his choice or as an independent. This way, this position is directly accountable to the voters. Please vote on November 4th. Your vote is your voice.
Hello. My name is Janet Jackson, and I'm the Oakland County Commissioner for District 21. First of all, this evening, I'd really like to thank Southwestern Oakland Cable for allowing us this opportunity to address the community and our constituents. First, I'd like to share some things about my personal life. I'm a mother of two. I'm a graduate of Spring Arbor University. I have a bachelor's in management and organization development. I've worked at a major accounting firm. I've held real estate license. I've worked in commercial and residential banking and lending. I've worked for DTE and AT&T utility companies in finance, customer service, and administration. I've also held real estate in the county and taught at Oakland County Schools. Currently, I'm serving my third term as a county commissioner for District 21, which serves a portion of Southfield and a portion of Farmington Hills. Actually, there are three commissioners serving Farmington and Farmington Hills. During my tenure on the commission, I have sponsored many child safety and internet fairs, also resource fairs for those facing need in the county, and neighborhood bonding events. Currently, I'm one of the founding members of the Oakland County Human Trafficking Study Group. And what we're doing, we're furthering community awareness about the crime and working in a multi-agency collaboration to establish safe haven and support legislation to aid those who are survivors of this crime. As a member of the Human Resources, Planning and Building Committee and Public Service Committees on the Commission, I've made decisions critical to efficient county operation and maintained a balanced budget. I feel the top three priorities that the County Commission should address are as follows. One, the roads. As we know, the roads are still in a state of disrepair, and I will support funding for collaborative efforts to fix the most needed of repair first. And I will promote customer service efforts for our road commission, for our drivers, and advocate for increased claim assistance for those needing repairs on their cars because of the roads. The second would be job creation and workforce development. I want to further efforts ensuring small business finance through our microloan programs at the county and support partnering with initiatives to help start businesses and careers. I want to also work to increase regional workforce development funding for those requiring training to work here in Oakland County and the region. The third is our quality of life. We all know that Oakland County is a vibrant place to live, especially the cities of Farmington and Farmington Hills. I want to continue to help support a regional transportation plan and work towards safer communities, starting, as I already stated, with resources for our children to help them, their parents, and educators navigate their world and the internet more safely. Lastly, as a former real estate agent, I want to join and work with our current realtors and neighborhood groups because I know that Farmington Hills is a community of subdivisions and homeowners associations with the residents very proud of where they live. And I want to work with these groups as we begin to remarket our viable community. So remember, on Election Day, November the 4th, vote for me, Janet Jackson, for Oakland County Commissioner, District 21. I won't let you down. And remember, vote for me. I'm a Democrat. Thank you.
I'm Richard Bernstein, and I am a Democratic endorsed candidate for the Michigan Supreme Court. I have come to learn through facing challenges, obstacles, difficulties, hardships, that life is not always fair. But you know what? Our judges should be. Our judges must be. I believe in the idea of blind justice. I believe in the idea of fairness for all people. I want to bring blind justice to the Michigan Supreme Court. It is time that our courts become blind to special interests, blind to partisan politics, blind to political ideology. I want to fight for fairness. Fairness for all people. Fairness for the factory worker who's been injured on the job. Fairness for the senior who's afraid to go out of their home any time of day or night. Fairness for the single mother who's working desperately hard to put food on her table, pay her rent, and make it through for yet another day. When a case reaches the Michigan Supreme Court, the stakes simply couldn't be higher. The court affects every facet of our lives. Everything from the air that you breathe, to the water that you drink, to the schools that you attend, to your quality of life at the workplace, to the safety that should exist at the workplace, to the privacy that we must all come to respect. These are all issues that are defined and impacted by the Michigan Supreme Court. But what is remarkable is that over 30% of our state's voters do not vote their ballot the entire way through. Over 30% of our state's voters don't vote all the way through, which means they lose their voice. Their voice in defining such important issues. Their voice in defining the issues that affect so many of us in so many profound ways. I liken the situation to when you're in high school and you take an exam and you feel confident and you say to yourself, this is an exam I know I'm gonna do well on. I'm prepared, I'm focused. I know it's gonna go great. You hand it in and the next day the teacher gives it back to you and you realize you got a C. So you approach the teacher and you say, I don't get it. These were all questions that I knew. And the teacher says to you, yes, indeed. You got every question on the front side correct, but you didn't turn the exam over. And by not doing so, you missed all the questions on the back side. I'm here today to ask that you please vote your ballot all the way through. I'm here today that you please go to the Michigan Supreme Court section on the ballot, and I'm here to ask for your support. I'm here to ask for your vote. My name is Richard Bernstein. I'm a candidate for the Michigan Supreme Court. And if I am able to convince you to please finish your ballot and vote all the way through, then the one promise I can make is that Michigan can have true and profound blind justice.
Hello, my name is Bill Murphy, and I'm a candidate for the Michigan Supreme Court. The Michigan Supreme Court, a judicial race, is found on the nonpartisan portion of the ballot. So when you go to vote, you need to go to the nonpartisan portion of the ballot, either at the bottom of the ballot or on the back, to vote for judges. I am currently the Chief Judge of the Michigan Court of Appeals. The Michigan Court of Appeals is the second highest court in the state, second only to the Michigan Supreme Court. The Court of Appeals handles thousands of appeals a year and is the court of last resort for roughly 98% of the appeals in this state. I have been a judge on the Michigan Court of Appeals for 26 years, during which time I have been called upon to rule in thousands of appeals, covering virtually every area of the law. In addition, the Supreme Court, in recognition of my leadership and administrative abilities, has, on three occasions, appointed me Chief Judge of the Michigan Court of Appeals. In the capacity of Chief Judge, I provide leadership to 27 judicial colleagues, a staff of 180, and an annual budget in excess of $22 million. During my tenure as Chief Judge, I'm proud the Michigan Court of Appeals has received national recognition as one of the leading appellate courts in the country. Prior to becoming a judge, I practiced law for 17 years, representing people in all walks of life, in dealing with a variety of legal and personal problems that my clients brought to me. I'm seeking election to the Michigan Supreme Court because I truly believe that my professional and life experiences as a practicing lawyer, as an experienced appellate judge, as a proven administrator, will enable me to make an immediate, meaningful contribution to the Supreme Court in its service to you, the public. No other candidate for the court has more practical or judicial appellate experience than me. I have the experience to judge what is right. Now, the fact that I have a little gray in my hair reflects that I have a number of years of life experiences as well. And as they say, with age comes wisdom. I believe wisdom is one of the important attributes of anyone serving on the Michigan Supreme Court. On a personal level, my wife and I have been married for 47 years. We have four grown daughters, of whom we are very proud, great son-in-laws, and seven grandchildren, whom we love dearly. I am greatly interested in their future, as well as yours, and how the court system can best serve them. So when you go to vote, be sure to go to the nonpartisan portion of the ballot. Look for the Supreme Court race. Look for the name Bill Murphy. I would be honored if you would give me one of your two votes. Thank you for considering me, Bill Murphy, for the Supreme Court.
Hi, I'm Justice David Viviano of the Michigan Supreme Court. Thank you for taking the time to learn more about the candidates in my race. I'm a rule of law judge. That means I understand that the role of a judge is limited to interpreting and applying the law fairly in the cases that come before our court. Judges are not policymakers and should defer to the policymaking choices of the legislature. My judicial philosophy is consistent with our founding principles, in particular the separation of powers. It's also consistent with our right of self-government, and it's necessary for us to remain free as a people. I grew up in Macomb County as part of a large family. My wife, Niran, and I have three children of our own, and we're expecting our fourth child early next year. I grew up working in a family business, the Viviano Flower Shop, and there I learned the value of hard work and to take pride in a job well done. I went to Hillsdale College and the University of Michigan Law School. After law school, I worked for two large law firms, one in Detroit and one in Chicago, before starting my own firm in Mount Clemens. I also served as the Centerline City Attorney. My judicial experience includes service on the Macomb County Circuit Court and the Civil Criminal Division, and I also served as the Chief Judge of Macomb County immediately before taking my new job on the Supreme Court. Judges run on the nonpartisan portion of the ballot, which is at the end of the ballot, and I'm running for the partial term seat. To learn more about me, please visit my website, www.vivianoforjustice.com, or my Facebook page, facebook.com/JusticeDavidViviano. On the Facebook page, there's a lot of personal information, and I think that will really give you a good idea of what I'm all about. I'm honored to serve on the Michigan Supreme Court. It's a public trust and not one that I take lightly. Please remember to vote for me, Justice David Viviano, when you vote on November 4th or fill out your absentee ballot. I hope I can count on your support.
Hello, my name is Karen Geibel, and I am a candidate for the open seat in the Oakland County Circuit Court this election. I am running for judge because I believe that I am the best qualified for the position. You might agree that most people don't know who to vote for when it comes to judges, perhaps because it is a nonpartisan seat, or maybe they have never had a reason to visit a court. I'm grateful for this opportunity to share a few things about myself, what I do, and why I'm running for circuit court judge. On a personal note, I've been married to my husband, Sean, for almost 15 years, and I'm a very proud mom to four amazing children, ages 13 to 6. We are a very busy household. I am a proud resident and employee of Oakland County, having worked in the circuit court for almost 14 years. I attended Michigan State University and received a degree in political science pre-law. I went to Cooley Law School on the weekends while working full-time. In 2001, I earned my Juris Doctorate with a concentration in litigation. And nearly my entire legal career has been spent working in public service. In 1999, I began clerking for Judge Rudy Nichols in the Oakland County Circuit Court, where my job was to serve the public by assisting the judge in courtroom proceedings, managing jurors seated during trial, meeting with attorneys and clients on pretrial conferences, and even writing recommendations on motions. After obtaining my license to practice law, I worked at a private insurance defense law firm for about 18 months, where I participated in all phases of litigation. In November 2004, I returned to the Oakland County Circuit Court, where I have served the past 10 years in my current position as Judicial Staff Attorney to the Honorable Rudy J. Nichols. My role as Judicial Staff Attorney is not much different to that of a judge. First and foremost, is the practice that the legal system exists to serve the public. On a daily basis, I research and apply the law on legal issues brought before the court, study and utilize the Michigan court rules and rules of evidence, prepare rulings both oral and written on all dispositive, appellate, and injunctive issues, work with attorneys on pretrial matters to make sure they are best prepared for trial, participate in settlement conferences with a focus on conflict resolution, and participate in docket management and make recommendations for alternative dispute resolution. A courtroom is a forum for disputes, and there are many different kinds. Whether it is a neighborly property line dispute, an auto injury case, a divorce, or even a criminal case, each case is significant and both sides deserve a fair judge. Over the past 14 years, I've learned what it takes to run an efficient and effective courtroom. I help make the varied legal decisions that make our courthouse most effective. I believe good attributes of a judge start with the legal ability to render sound decisions in a concise and timely manner. A judge should have knowledge of the law and courtroom procedure. A judge should be fair and impartial. I've learned that there is always two sides to every story, and a decision should be made after both have an opportunity to be heard. Judges should have good family values and provide service to the community. My family is my first priority. I understand what it takes to juggle a family and a career while at the same time teaching my kids to be active in the community. For example, my involvement in the Rochester area JCs, or participation in the Michigan High School mock trial tournament every year, and even teaching catechism at my church. A judge should have excellent time management and organizational skills. As a mom of four, full-time employee, small business owner with my husband, volunteer softball coach, and too many others to list, I'm forced to plan ahead. A judge should be open-minded, fair, and assertive when needed. I practice all of these attributes on a daily basis. So what makes me qualified to be the next circuit court judge? My hands-on courtroom experience and passion for my job. I love what I do and feel a sense of accomplishment in the work I perform. I honestly cannot see myself doing anything different, and I'm ready to take my career to the next level. If elected, I promise to be present, prepared, and ready to serve. Please visit my website for more information about me, KarenForJudge.com, and consider giving Geibel the gavel when you vote November 4th. If I'm elected, I say with confidence that I'll hit the ground running. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Lisa Langton, a candidate for judge in the Oakland County Circuit Court's Family Division. One of the biggest challenges I face in this race is not about the campaign at all. The biggest challenge is educating the public about the Family Division of the court. As a judge in the Family Court, I'll be presiding over juvenile abuse, neglect, and delinquency cases. Many of those who appear before me won't have an attorney by their side. As an expert in family law, I understand that all cases in family court are time sensitive. Juvenile cases are not the same as adult cases. An abused child does not have the luxury of waiting for a judge to get around to his case. The quicker we get an abused child into a permanent home, the better chance that child will have to lead a healthy, productive life. A judge in the family court also deals with all domestic cases. Many people have been touched by divorce in this country. Sadly, we all know someone who has not been well served by the court system. Guiding a family through the emotional minefield of a divorce isn't just a matter of dividing up the pots and pans. We are dealing with adults who need a chance to be a better parent after a marriage has ended. And we're dealing with children who need stability and the promise that they will grow up in a safe and loving home. For 25 years, I have championed the rights of children and families in my private practice. As the Deputy Court Administrator, my current job, I've helped develop the family court into a model for the state of Michigan. In fact, I have been the only person in Oakland County to run the family court since its creation in 1998. That means I already understand the computer systems for the court. I know all about e-filing and our mainframe system and case management systems. I know all those systems because as Deputy Court Administrator, it's my job to know. I also know that being a judge involves a lot of paperwork and it must be done right. A family division judge has to ensure that federal and state funding isn't jeopardized because the paperwork wasn't done correctly. I know all about that mountain of paperwork because I train our new judges on that critical part of managing a family docket. You have a choice when you go to the polls on November 4th. I am the only candidate on the ballot who has actually represented kids and families in court.
I am the only candidate who has experience creating and managing a family division docket, and I am the only candidate who has tried cases in our courts throughout the state. I've tried cases in probate court, district court, and circuit court. I've also tried cases in federal courts, including the United States Court of Appeals. Here's why that's important. I know what it's like to carry the burden and responsibility that comes with actually representing a client. I know what it's like to conduct a trial, to stand shoulder to shoulder with someone at his most vulnerable, and know that his future depends on me, his advocate, his lawyer. That's what trusted experience is all about, and you don't get that from standing on the sidelines. You have to earn it. Now, I understand that we can learn a lot from books. I was an honor graduate in both college and in law school. That meant I spent a lot of time with books. But I also understand that there are some things you just can't learn by going to the library. No one ever learned to ride a bicycle by reading a book. Being a judge is more than knowing the law. Knowing the law is just the starting point. A good judge is forthright, honest, and reinforces knowledge of the law with patience, hard work, but mostly experience. I'm asking your vote on November 4th because I already have the experience and knowledge needed. I won't need any on-the-job training. I have seen the difference a good judge can make in the lives of our family, and I will be that good judge.
My name is Al G, and I'm running for OCC Board of Trustees. I'm the father of three children. My youngest daughter just graduated from MSU. I've been teaching for 26 years in the domain of mathematics. I taught at OCC Community College, and I also taught at high school level. As some of you might know, I was a candidate for Michigan State Senate in District 13, which is Rochester, Troy, Royal Oak, Birmingham area, in the last primaries. During that campaign, affordable higher education was on the top of my list. And it's remained as such today in the midst of skyrocketing college tuition. I'm fighting for affordable college tuition and for more profitable college degrees. I'm running for OCC Board of Trustees to help our community strive and make OCC an institution that is welcoming for all applicants who qualify, regardless of their age, their national origin, and their accent. The difference between me and other candidates is the fact that I'm consistent, I'm crystal clear about opposing higher education tuition rising. I oppose high cost education at the higher education, at the higher level. Other thing is, I work relentlessly to improve education in Michigan from the bottom up. And today I'm asking for your support for OCC Board of Trustees, and I guarantee you, when you vote for me, I'll be present on campuses at least twice a month to talk to instructors, to talk to students, in order to understand their need and give some correct answer to whatever they ask for. I'm working to improve education. Also, what I will do is I will make sure that full-time employment opportunities are given to those who are 40 years or more, not only those who are less than 40 years old. Other thing I'm fighting for is I will not go to OCC to impede on benefit. I will not ask for taxing people retirement. I will not ask for salary reductions. I'm there to help, not to create more issues. I can guarantee you that I'm not going to implement an agenda for special interests. I will work only for the community, for the student. That's why I'm asking for your help. My number is 248-818-3017. My email is michiganvoting@gmail.com. Again, my phone number is 248-818-3017. The email is michiganvoting@gmail.com. I want to count on you. May God bless you, and I count on you again on November 4th. Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm John McCullough, and I'm running for Oakland Community College trustee. As director of the Huron-Clinton Metro Parks, a CPA attorney, former Oakland County Water Resources Commissioner, and chairman of the Board of Commissioners, I have the experience and expertise to help guide Oakland Community College into the future. As the largest community college in the state, it's important that OCC be a model for academic excellence and prepare students for the highly technical and skilled jobs of the future. With more than 24 years' experience working with public boards, as both a member and director, I'm ready to hit the ground running. As an Oakland Community College trustee, I will advocate for building partnerships with four-year colleges and universities, and collaborating with private sector across Southeast Michigan. This will help prepare students for the high-tech, high-skilled jobs needed in this global economy. Ensuring the continued financial health of OCC is a priority to me. As a steward of taxpayer dollars, financial policy decisions can have long-term effects on the college. Fiscal responsibility with an eye towards student achievement is vital to the continued success of OCC. I will strive to close the socioeconomic achievement gap in diverse groups by providing educational opportunities to all in Southeast Michigan. Ensuring that students from all backgrounds receive access to the educational programs that OCC has to offer will help to close these gaps. This is critical to the long-term success of the college and the region. For more information or to contact me, visit my Facebook page, or if you prefer, you can email me directly at mccullohforocc@yahoo.com. Again, that's mccullohforocc@yahoo.com. I'm John McCullough, asking for your support and vote on November 4th for Oakland Community College trustee.
Hello, my name is Chris Nordhorn, and I'm running for Oakland Community College Board of Trustees in the November 4th election. I joined Oakland Community College in July 1965 as a charter faculty member, where I helped develop the college course catalog utilizing my recent degree in comparative literature I received from the University of Michigan. I retired from full-time teaching at OCC in 1999, and remained as an adjunct or part-time faculty until May of this year. I believe the current board makeup, while professionally represented, lacks input from an educator. As OCC celebrates its 50th anniversary, I too will bring my 50 years of OCC teaching experience to the board. Throughout my career as OCC faculty, I was actively involved beyond the classroom as union bargainer, chair for the Communications Humanities Department, advisor to the campus newspaper, the Highland Voice, and a member of several committees, including the OCC Foundation Council. I'm grateful for the opportunities OCC has provided my family, my students, and the community. I would like to continue to serve OCC and help shape its future with my diverse and extensive educational experience, interests, and talents. Here are the important issues I see that OCC is facing and my response to each. Issue number one, in a time when some community colleges are dropping the word community from their names and shrinking their roles in their community, Oakland Community College must not follow this marketing trend and instead set itself apart, strengthening its commitment and live up to its motto, community is our middle name. Issue number two, changing demographics. As our population ages, OCC can serve this growing demographic's interests by providing lifelong learning opportunities and activities. With many of our district voters retiring, OCC is in a unique position to provide those lifelong interests and activities that continue to expand the intellect, as well as maintain and strengthen their involvement in the community, garnering their continued support. Issue number three, higher education funding and budget matters. As the state's largest community college dependent on public support, OCC must prove its efficiency and value to the state and exert pressure on our legislators and politicians in Lansing to make funding for our higher education institution a top priority. I believe the role of an OCC board member is to help plan and guide the course of the college, community, and student population, and to assist in hiring management executives and hold them to the standards for which they were hired. I believe the OCC board should request and survey all available information sources, especially by reintegrating the role of the Academic Senate, whereby we can make informed recommendations based on this input with a plan for adjustments as new circumstances and information warrant. In addition, I believe trustee meetings should be rotated throughout all campus locales at least once a year, so all members of a particular community may have the ability to participate. Open meeting agendas, video audio recordings, and live broadcasts and decisions should be made available to the public. OCC's mission must constantly evolve to ensure that it is able to continue to adjust, fulfill, and expand its relevance to the community and its accessibility to its citizens, as well as its affordability by providing and proving its extraordinary value to voters and legislators. I look forward to your support on November 4th as your voice in the community at the OCC Board of Trustees. Thank you.
On November 4, we will be voting for more than just the governor. Hello, my name is Dennis Paul Francis O'Connor, and I am seeking a 6-year term on the Oakland Community College Board of Trustees. Oakland voters will elect two people from a large field of 11 candidates to sit on the board. I would be honored to serve you as one of those board members. I'm asking for your support and vote because I offer you the experience, knowledge, dedication, and passion that you want, and quite frankly, that you deserve from an OCC trustee. Over the years, I have demonstrated what voters expect from a public servant, a hardworking, fiscally conservative person who is focused on providing the best education possible for our young adults. I have a proven track record as a good steward of taxpayer dollars. I offer the type of independent critical thinking on issues that Oakland County voters expect from their educational leaders. And I am laser focused on making sure that your tax dollars are invested properly on student achievement so that our young adults will be properly trained and career ready for 21st century jobs in a global workforce environment. Now, for those of you who may not know me, I am the president of the Novi Board of Education. I was first elected to the Novi School Board in November 2008, and I was overwhelmingly reelected to that same post in November 2012. I was the top vote getter in both elections. I also serve as a trustee on the Oakland County School Boards Association Board of Directors, an elected position by my peers who serve on the 28 local public school boards in Oakland County. My family has lived in Oakland County our entire adult life. My wife, Gail, is a graduate of Oakland Community College. We've been married 32 years and we have 2 grown daughters. We lived in the city of Southfield from 1982 to 1986
before moving to the city of Novi. I was transferred out of state in the mid-1990s, but we returned to Oakland County and Novi in 1998 to reconnect with a community where educational excellence and academic achievement are top priorities. Now, my platform for Oakland Community College is based on three strong and very powerful words: optimism, collaboration, and cooperation. That stands for OCC. I'm optimistic that Oakland Community College will narrow the educational skills gap that hinders our state's potential for dynamic economic growth. To accomplish this, OCC needs to create industry-specific vocational training programs so that our young adults will develop skills to meet the demands of Michigan employers. I believe in collaboration because it's important that OCC officials meet, listen, understand, and fulfill the local community needs for businesses, school districts, and municipalities. Lastly, it's all about cooperation. OCC needs to partner with Oakland County businesses and corporations by delivering the talent they need to compete in the global marketplace. OCC also needs to partner with the state of Michigan to close the state's skills gaps, especially in the advanced manufacturing and medical industries. Now, I've received a major endorsement from Oakland County Executive L. Brooks Patterson. Mr. Patterson's endorsement of my candidacy is supported by a long list of current and former elected public officials, including Oakland County Commissioner and Chair Mike Gingell, Oakland County Commissioner Kathy Crawford, State Senator Mike Kowal, former State Senator Nancy Cassis, State Representative Hugh Crawford, Novi Mayor Bob Gatt, and former Novi Mayor David Landry. These great public servants recognize my leadership skills and my commitment to public service for Oakland County. Thank you for your time. Please visit my website at DennisO'Connor.org to learn more about me, my beliefs, and my educational priorities. And most of all, don't forget to vote for O'Connor on November 4. Thank you.
Hello, my name is E. Russell Sherrod III. I am a writing candidate for Oakland Community College Trustee Board. The reason why I am running for a seat on the Trustee Board is because of overspending, higher tuition, and no focus on helping students learn to achieve their goals. As a trustee, I will vote on issues that concern helping students learn all they can to graduate or be prepared to transfer to any four-year university. I'd like to create more work-study programs as well as more scholarship opportunities to help students pay for school and place on a job where they are majoring in to gain the skills needed. For example, a student who wants to major in criminal justice can work on campus in the public safety office as a public safety explorer, cadet. And when they graduate, they can continue working and get the support to get them a full-time job working in their related field. In addition, Oakland Community College can have an in-house public safety dispatch center where calls from staff, students, faculty, and visitors can speak with cadets instead of placed on hold when calling Oakland County Sheriff, as they have their own calls to focus on. It is past time for Oakland Community College to have an in-house public safety dispatch center. Oakland Community College continues to raise tuition and not giving in-district students a break. Low tuition at a price that is affordable for all students who want to attend Oakland Community College. The textbooks and other materials in the bookstore will be affordable for all students to buy, and I will find ways to help students get the material they need for their classes without having them spend a whole lot on books. Oakland Community College Library and Academic Support Center will be available to students at 1 o'clock to help students continue working on papers that they have to prepare and get ready for their classes and allow them to print their papers without having to deal with the system that they already dealing with now. Many universities are looking for office space to lease buildings to expand their schools to provide convenient locations for students to get to classes. And Oakland Community College can provide space for some of those universities. I do believe Oakland Community College needs to add another campus off of West 8 Mile area for students who live off of 8 Mile area. On November 4th, 2014, I asked you to write in my name on Oakland Community College trustee. Together we can take Oakland Community College to the next level and train all students for success. Thank you for your time, and if you want to contact me, feel free to call me at 248-885-9384.
Hello, my name is Tricia Blazovic. I'm a candidate for the Farmington Public Schools District Board of Education. Growing up in Northern Michigan, friends from the Farmington area would travel up every summer to spend time with us. I was so impressed with the opportunities that were available to those children. Because of that, I've known since I was in high school that I wanted to live in Farmington Hills. A few years after graduating from Michigan State, I began working for CompuWare Corporation. I just celebrated my 10-year anniversary, currently serving as the Director of Quality and Sustainability. I've also been a certified Six Sigma Black Belt since 2006. My husband Matt and I bought our home in Farmington Hills over 11 years ago because of the school district. Our son Thomas is 9 years old and a fourth grader at Kenbrook Elementary. Our daughter Grayson is 4 years old and she'll start in kindergarten at Kenbrook in the fall of 2015. Currently, I'm fulfilling the remaining term of trustee Priscilla Briette. Mrs. Briette announced her retirement in December of 2013. In March, I applied for, interviewed, and was appointed as a trustee to the Farmington Public Schools Board of Education. During the past 6 months that I've been serving in the position that I hope to be elected to, I've had the opportunity to gain more thorough understanding of our district. As a current board member, I participated in and experienced two of the most important activities the board must perform. First was having to cut $12 million from the budget, and the second was the selection and hiring process of our new superintendent. That all took place within the first 3.5 months on the board. It felt like the most accelerated course ever, but it gave me the opportunity to see where our district needs help to improve. That's why I want to continue to serve by being elected on November 4th. Three of the top issues facing our district are curriculum, finance, and infrastructure. Starting with curriculum, the most important responsibility our district has is to ensure our students are prepared for the world they're entering after they graduate from Farmington Public Schools. In order for that to happen, we need to give our students access to appropriate curriculum. To me, that means we have to offer amazing arts programs, technically challenging field trades, and appropriately challenging academic courses for all students. We must close the achievement gap. While we support the struggling student, we must also support the accelerated learner through offering curriculum that challenges them. I understand this is easier said than done. There are only so many teachers, hours in a day, and dollars to be spent. This is where we have to think out of the box to figure out how we offer students what they need with limited resources. The next priority issue is finance, dealing with our budget. The FPS general fund balance is not where it should be. Board of Education policy states that the fund balance target is between 8 and 12%. For this school year, the fund balance will be approximately 5%. The state of Michigan has significantly reduced the amount of funding per student that our district receives, while costs to fund the mandatory retirement system have increased. This school year, the state of Michigan announced that Farmington Public Schools would receive $50 per pupil increase. However, the cost of the retirement plan increased by $75 per pupil. We actually had our funding cut by $25 per student. The cuts in funding are a reality for almost all the public school districts in southeastern Michigan. Other districts have found a way to make the funding allocated to the per student work for their district. We need to benchmark those districts to find out what worked for them and analyze if it could work for us too. Our focus needs to be on our future, not dwelling on decisions that were made in the past. I believe our district would benefit positively from implementing quality improvement methodologies while also bringing about additional transparency with our community. And finally, infrastructure. The school buildings in our district are old. By replacing those old systems rather than continually repairing them, the district could save money. We would recoup the cost of the new unit through the savings of new energy efficient systems, as well as on the labor costs of repair. By being proactive, we can also reduce or eliminate the cost of emergency repair. There are a number of facts and current realities that we need to accept in order to move forward. The updates are needed. We need to determine a way to pay for them. The district and the community need to come together to get it done. For these reasons, I requested to serve on the Building Site Safety Committee. While there are needs to attend to, I also believe it's very important to closely monitor our facilities usage as well as enrollment. We need to consider all possible alternatives for our facilities. Does utilization allow for us to repurpose a facility that was less costly to update? I mentioned earlier that I'm a certified Six Sigma Black Belt. In everyday terms, it means that my expertise is in problem solving, quality planning, and improvement. This methodology can be implemented on an automotive parts assembly line, but it can also be applied in everyday life. For the past 8 years in my career on a daily basis, I problem solve, plan, and improve. I would use my skill set in the same way to help Farmington Public Schools become best in class again. In summary, I want to be a trustee on the Farmington Public Schools Board of Education because there's still a lot of work to do. I have the knowledge of the district and the skill set to analyze the pains, identify the gaps, and quality improvement experience to ensure successful implementation of the improvements. I would also continually monitor the improvements we make to make sure they're having the intended effect. I want to continue working hard for Farmington Public Schools. Please help me do that by voting for me, Tricia Belazovic, on November 4th.
Hello, I'm Jessica Cummings, candidate for election to the Farmington Public Schools Board of Education. Thank you to Southwestern Oakland Cable Commission and staff for creating this opportunity to inform the community about the candidates. My husband and I have three children attending Farmington Public Schools. For the last 8 years, I've been an active PTA member and involved in school events, classrooms, and extracurricular activities. I've spent countless hours in classrooms where I've had an opportunity to meet teachers, students, staff, administrators, and parents. I have a BA in Human Development and Social Relations. Additionally, I've been a licensed attorney for 15 years. I serve as an adjunct assistant professor at a local university where I teach business law and related courses. Also, I manage a youth sports team. I'm running for the board because I value the educational system and know the importance of providing a quality educational foundation for all students, critical for their future success and significant to the quality of our community. My skills and experience are necessary during challenging times. Quality education for our students and community must be diligently pursued. I dedicate myself to supporting and leading the district as it provides a high level quality of education, contributing to a strong community. I will consider myself a partner working with students, parents, teachers, administrators, staff, and community. I anticipate that there will be many difficult decisions brought before the board in the near future. The financial situation in the district and other challenging issues will test the board's abilities when making decisions. My goal is to support and lead the district in a direction that will provide a high quality of education. I will work to develop and vote on policies improving the quality of education for every student. Students need challenging opportunities guiding them in critical developmental years leading to their success. I will evaluate issues from different perspectives because I will listen to and consider all viewpoints presented to me. It is imperative that the board communicate with the legislature in Lansing. Currently, the board must approve the annual budget by July 1st. However, school begins before the state approves the budget. This makes the task of balancing the budget very challenging. Additionally, the state has cut a cumulative total of $19 million for our district over the last 4 years. These are issues that must be communicated to our state representative and senator. We must call on them to fix this system, which poses great challenges to the district. Another priority issue facing the district is the achievement gap and efforts to close it. Reviewing the recent state rankings, one may think that our district is struggling. Although there are issues that must receive our attention, such as the achievement gap, there are many positive aspects of the district that must be celebrated and continued. For example, many of our students have the opportunity to complete AP courses and college-level courses in high school. Students who need extra support are receiving that support. As a board member, I will work to create policies helping every child succeed. Teachers face challenges and need tools to develop strategies enabling students from all backgrounds to succeed. Successful actions used to close the achievement gap must continue. Creativity is needed developing effective new strategies to address this issue and also to ensure that successful work with all students at every academic level continues. Communication and trust are priorities for the board. As a board member, I will strive to be a leader and community partner. I will listen to and consider all interests. It is important to consistently and frequently communicate openly with all interested parties. I will be a listener and work to understand all viewpoints. I hope you agree that my skills, qualifications, and dedication make me the board member candidate for Farmington Public Schools who has earned your vote this upcoming November 4th election. I appreciate your time and attention. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Terry Johnson. I'm a candidate for Farmington Public Schools Board of Education. Ladies and gentlemen, I need your help. In our cities of Farmington and Farmington Hills, we have tremendous assets. We have tremendous services. But the greatest asset we have, ladies and gentlemen, are our kids. Ladies and gentlemen, our kids are very important. We need to focus on our education, or the kids' education here in the Farmington Public Schools. As some of you are aware, over the past few years, our numbers for testing in the MEEP and other standardized tests have gone down. Yet our district is constantly and repeatedly pouring more and more money into the district while the numbers are going down. Ladies and gentlemen, we need to do better. What we need to do, ladies and gentlemen, is make sure that our kids are getting the best education, a 21st century education, one that we all can be proud of. Right now, ladies and gentlemen, we're not doing that. I'm going to need your help on November 4th. Terry Johnson for School Board. We need to bring a sense of community back to Farmington Public Schools. We need to get all of us involved so that our biggest assets can achieve. Our biggest assets can grow. Our biggest assets can continue to come back and invest in our community. Our biggest assets, ladies and gentlemen, are our children. Our children, your children. I currently have 3 kids in the Farmington Public Schools. I am involved in their education. I want the whole community to be involved in everyone's education. We need to measure our students, student by student, success by success. If elected, ladies and gentlemen, I'll make sure I'm a responsible steward of your tax dollars. We're not going to waste dollars on gimmicks and schemes, but we're going to use the tax dollars that we collect to ensure that our kids are learning, our kids are growing, our kids are achieving. And finally, ladies and gentlemen, I'll make sure that our kids are safe and secure, not only in the schools, but around the schools. Again, our biggest asset is our children. And remember, I need your help. November 4th, Terry Johnson. Remember, your ballot's not done till you vote for Johnson.
This fall, 2 of my grandchildren, Tessa and Connor, started kindergarten in Farmington Hills. I have a vested interest in the next 13 years of their schooling. Last fall, when voters rejected 2 bond issues in 4 months, I wondered if voters were saying, Farmington schools can't manage the dollars they have, why give them more? For the answer, I dug into school operations and got a queasy feeling with what I found. I no longer had the option of sitting on the sidelines. I decided to run for school board. There are 3 primary issues: cost control, educational quality, and board leadership. First, I am a numbers guy, an accountant, a chief financial officer. And when I reviewed the district's finances, what I found was that our schools are running out of money. Expenses are significantly higher than revenues. Accountants call that a loss. And that has happened for most of the last 10 years. Here are examples of what I found when I reviewed the finances. After depleting nearly $50 million in reserves over the last 10 years, this year the board has budgeted another loss, this time $5.5 million. Worse, back on page 305 of the budget, I found they actually project losses of $47 million over the next 3 years. That's emergency manager territory. I want to correct our course to avoid the need for such a drastic action. Our revenue is driven by student enrollment levels, and our enrollment has been declining. When enrollments decline, revenues decline too. There is no pot of gold to bail us out. We must review our costs and match them to our expected enrollment and revenue to get them under control. If you elect me, I will help the school board tackle this common sense solution. Our new superintendent, George H., knows this, and I will help him. I spent my career working with nonprofit organizations, improving cash flows and improving their bottom lines. I know how to do that. That brings us to my second issue, educational quality. Our kids have a right to expect excellence in their education. But the Michigan School Accountability Scorecard that measures educational quality shows Farmington Public Schools in the middle of the pack. Mediocrity is not excellence. In addition, 13 of the 17 Farmington schools were flagged focus schools because of the large gap between high-performing and low-performing students. We have the double challenge of improving at the top while driving up the bottom even faster. A key point I want to make here is that I do not believe we have a teacher quality issue. Overall, we are fortunate to have great teachers, but they need our support, and they need the tools to do their work effectively. That brings me to my third point, school board leadership. Boards are responsible for establishing goals and providing the leadership necessary to reach those goals. For a school board, those goals must include providing the highest quality education possible for students at all levels. Leadership is developing the strategies and policies that allow us to attract and retain high-quality teachers. It is about using financial common sense to renew and maintain high-quality facilities and equipment. Sound school board leadership avoids creating the condition in which we find ourselves today, where undisciplined spending has good teachers struggling with worn-out tools in their efforts to provide great educational outcomes. I ask you to elect me to our school board and help provide that much leadership for us to do better. Cost control, educational quality, and board leadership are my focus, and I will appreciate your vote for Farmington Public Schools Board. You can find more information about me and my plans at lubaway4value.com. That's L-U-B-A-W-A-Y, the number 4, V-A-L-U-E.com. Thank you.